In this video, we're going to look at how to analyze the results of our random art experiment. Now, here's a random art experiment that I found online. The person rolled some dice, and with each roll of the die, they drew a different pattern. So with a 1, they drew this pattern. With a 2, they drew this pattern, and so on and so forth. In this grid, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's 36 squares in here, and they wrote, oh my god, fives. So I'm going to focus my analysis on their little comment right here. Now, you can focus on their little comment if you think that's appropriate, or something else that happened that you might notice. So they wrote, oh my god, fives. So let's take a look at that. Here's the fives right here. There's orange dots. And I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 fives. So we're looking at 36 rolls of a dice, and 11 of them were fives. Does that warrant the comment, oh my god, fives? So the first question that I presented was basically to find the probability of that event, or some other thing that you're looking at, and then discuss it. Was that an event likely? How do you know? Show your work, justify your reasoning. In this video, we're going to use Desmos. So let's go there. So I'm going to type in desmos.com. It's going to take me to that website. And I think it's important to log in. You want to log in. Choose your Google account. It'll log you in. Yes, log me in. Now it'll save my work. And I'm going to go to my graphing calculator here. Anything I type in now, I can save. Except, all right. So we're looking at binomial probabilities here. And one thing that's cool about Desmos is you can enter combinations quickly if you type little n, capital C, R, and the numbers you're looking at. So let's say, as a random choice, I want to look at 4, choose 3. I can just type in 4 and 3. And it gives me that combination. So as you work, if you want to use this approach using combinations directly, you can do that. I'm going to enter in using the combination formula with factorials as I work through this. So in this case, right here, what's the binomial probability density function tell us? Well, it tells us, let's do our combination first, and I'm going to just write this out. We had 36 rolls, and we're choosing 11. Right, there are lots of ways to do that. It looks like 600 million ways to pick 11 fives out of 36, right? Different ways of grouping that. So that's a lot of arrangements of probabilities that we're looking at here, and that's what this probability function analyzes. So now I'm going to type that in. That's 36 factorial divided by a slash, and then I'm going to enter parentheses again, 11 factorial, and then 36 minus 11, close parentheses, factorial. That's the same thing, right? I'm just entering it as a formula. And I entered one too many parentheses. I don't need that. So there we go. Now I'm going to multiply that by the probability of getting a 5. So times, so shift 8. And then I'm going to do parentheses here, 1/6th. That's the chance of getting a 5. It's a six-sided die. And I'm getting 11 fives. So I hit shift 6 for an exponent, type 11, times, but before I hit times, I'm going to press the right arrow, times 5/6 to the, now the power here has to be all of the other rolls. It has to be 25. There were 11 rolls of fives. The rest are something else, so it's going to be the 25th power. Shift 6, 25. And that tells me the answer to the first question, 0.017. Now, if I was writing about this, as you will be, I would say, well, there's less than a 2% chance, right? That's 1.7%. And how do I know? I would show this formula right here. This is the approximation. So that's given me an answer, and I've solved it. Now, what I want to do is sort my work in Desmos. So I'm going to use folders to do that. First, I'm going to clear this off. I don't need that. Then I'm going to click plus, add a folder. And I'm going to call this the binome PDF for 11 rolls of 5. Okay, so I'm going to drag this up by clicking here, dragging it up. Now I want this equation to be in this folder so I can clean it up. I'm going to just click here, and drag over to the right. You see the little line that appears there? Got it. Now it's hidden in the folder, and we've got an answer to question one. Let's move on. Next one. Share a graph of the outcomes and their probabilities. Why is the graph shaped the way it is? What do the points represent? Give a few examples and explain your reasoning. All right, so here's something really nice about Desmos, is that we can generalize the binome PDF formula. And the way I would do that, I'm going to use the variables n, r, p, and q as our typical. So I'm going to type in n factorial over r factorial, this is the combination of n choose r, times parentheses n minus r close parentheses factorial. Then I'm going to multiply that by the probability p. P is the event that we're looking for, in this case, rolling a 5, to the power of r. That's the number of successes. Then press right, shift 8q. Q is not rolling a 5. So that's going to be to the power of, and I'm going to use parentheses here, n minus r. It's all the other things that aren't r. And you'll notice that it says add slider right here. That means it's going to add sliders that produce values for each of these variables. I'm going to click all, and there it is. And I have an equation based on these assumptions of the variables, and I can drag this around to change the numbers. But I want to change a few things. Remember the context of what this formula tells us. N is the number of trials, and look at this right now. It's going from negative 10 to positive 10. That's not what I want. I can't have negative trials, right? So I'm going to click this, and I'm going to change it. N, I'm going to make the lowest n value, lowest number of trials, 0, all the way up to 36 is what we're looking at. And the increments, the steps, are going to be by 1s. I don't want to deal with half rolls. That wouldn't make sense. And then I go to R. R is the number of successes that we're looking at. And again, I'm going to limit it between 0 and 36. It corresponds to this experiment. Then the probability here, I'm going to go from 0 to 1. Remember, the lowest probability is 0, the highest is 1. I'm going to go up by 0.01s. And then Q, I'm going to say is, instead of giving it a range, I'm going to say it's 1 minus P. Remember the binomial probability that whatever P is, Q is 1 minus P. It's essentially the complement of that. All right, now here, in this case, we're going to see if our formula works. We should get, we know the answer is 0.01735. If I set N to 36, the number of trials, R the number of successes, 11, and then the probability here, instead of trying to scroll to 1.6, which is 0.16 repeating, I can't get that precision there, right? So I'm going to click on this and just type in, let's see if we can do a fraction. I don't know if I can. 1/6. Yay, I can. Now, if I type in 1.6, I lose that ability to get a slider, but that's okay. So that's one thing to think about. I think if I type a decimal, I don't lose a slider. Yep. So decimals keep that slider in. That's basically 1/6 for all intents and purposes. And you can see these decimals are basically identical here. The more sixes I add, right, the closer it will be. And now you can see they match. So what we just did was create a generic formula for the binomial PDF function. And now that's a lot of stuff there. It looks scary. I'm going to click plus and folder. And I'm going to type in binome PDF for, I did number of trials for n trials, right? So I'm gonna, that's my way of saving it. And then now I can clean it up even further. I'm gonna collapse this folder. I'm gonna say this is the first one is the binome PDF for 11, for 36 trials, excuse me. Now it's for n trials. And I just wanna drag all these things over, click and drag. So they're now part of that folder. And then we can use that formula. And you'll see how we use it in a moment to make a table. Go to click this arrow to collapse it. And isn't that nice and clean now? Now I want to add a table so I can make a graph. Go to click the plus button here. Go to pick a table. And there's lots of cool stuff you can do with these table functions. Watch this. I'm going to type in 0 and then 1. And then if I hit enter, 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 it gives me all the next values. Right? I want to go to 36 for myself. It depends what your art experiment is. It might be impossible to go make a table that goes all the way. You go pretty far at the table to get a graph that makes sense, and you'll see what I mean. Now, for the outputs, I don't want to calculate the binome PDFs for each of these values, so I'll have Desmos do it for me. I've already got a formula here. I'm going to select it, copy it, collapse that, and just paste it right in here, And nothing will happen yet. It's not that easy. We do a little bit more work. Now you see it enters numbers here, but that's entering a fixed value because it's assuming R is a certain value, but we want to change that. R is the number of successes, and that's what the X's represent here. So 0 5s, 1 5, 2 5s, 3 5s, 4 5, 5 5, so on and so forth. That's the number of 5s we're rolling. So you can see it says X sub 1. So instead of an R here, I'm going to delete that and type X, shift, line is the button next to the plus, and type a 1. And now it's going to pull that X value into the formula and calculate the result. But it's not correct yet. I've got to change all of the R's to X sub 1. To get a result. Keep going, don't forget to go to the right here. There it is, X sub 1, and then X sub 1. All right, now, this is really cool. I think at least we've got a table that shows you all the binome PDF values from 0 5s all the way up to getting 36, which is essentially impossible. But I don't see much here on the graph, so I'm gonna just click and drag it over. And if I hold the shift button, see that? I highlight there. So I hover and highlight, I just go whoop. Now I can drag it. So I get a nice picture of a graph here. Now in this question, it asks you to describe the shape of the graph. Think about what's happening here. See how it's, what's going on here? This graph, most likely events are up here, right? But getting beyond, you can see beyond 10, 11, what we had, and so on and so forth, essentially becomes impossible. Now you could squish this graph to see all 36, but use your best judgment. I think that could be valuable. You could talk about the shape of this graph, but also if you just kind of drag it out like this, I like that I can see the distribution of the X values more clearly. Now what I like to do is, if I'm highlighting a couple of points, like this one, there's 6. It's 0.1759, right? So it's about 17% chance of getting 6 fives. It's the most likely event. And that makes sense, right? You should get a 5 about 1/6 of the time. So you should expect exactly 6 fives the most often. But it's not as high as you might anticipate, but it's the most common event here. Then I click this one here, and that shows me the probability at 11 fives. Now you can do export image right here by sharing a graph. I like to just take a screenshot of this right here with the points highlighted. So if I'm going to write about it, get a little screenshot right there. If I'm going to write about it, I've got everything I need in my document to describe. Okay, now all of this, this is my table right here. I'm going to make a little folder for that. This is the binome PDF table for N trials. How does that look? Okay. Then I go here, and I'm just going to drag this over to the right. And now all of that work I have nice and neat in here. And I don't know if I have another question to answer here. Okay, discuss the probabilities around your exact event. What was the likelihood of the outcomes next to the outcome you discussed in question one? Why does that make sense? All right, so there's lots of ways to go about doing this. In my first folder here, I have this equation. So I'm going to actually use this equation as it stands. And then I want to look at, it's up to me, if there's the question leaves it open. I'll look at an event below, an event above this probability, right? So what's the likelihood that I roll 11 fives, 10 fives, or 12 fives near that event right there. So maybe not just 11, but close to it. How often would I expect that to happen? So I paste it. And I'm going to make the first, well, actually I'll do it twice. It's fastest to do this way, plus. So now I've got the probability of rolling 11 fives, and I also want to calculate the probability of rolling 10 fives here. And all I have to do is change these 11s to 10s. 10, 10, and oop, 10, yep. And then this has to go up to 30 to 26. So those fraction exponents have to always account for all 36 trials. And I'm going to paste, let's see, 11 rolls of a 5, and then 12 rolls of a 5. 12. Oops. And you know what? I think I made a mistake. Let me go back. I forgot to change one of the numbers, I believe. Ooh. Nope. Okay. I did not. You know what you can do? You can also, this is easier, drag it this way so you can see the whole equation. Okay, 11, 11, 11, 12, 12. This should be 12. And then this should be 24. All right. What this tells me is that I have about a 6% chance of getting a 10 or an 11 or a 12. Excuse me, to get 10 fives or 11 fives or 12 fives, right? So getting around there is a lot more likely than just getting exactly 11 rolls, right? So you can see that maybe getting near this thing is not so unlikely. That makes a little bit of sense. Just the 11 alone is a little bit below 2%, but near it, right, we've got about a 6% chance of this happening. So this right here, there's going to be more work we do with this. So I'm going to just add one more thing. This is going to be the binome PDF near 11 fives. I'm just sorting my work out. Just kind of drag that over, collapse it, boom. Now I've got everything I need organized in Desmos, but I've got to save it, right? Don't forget to save it. I'm going to click this right here. I'm going to put the random art project. Click save. It's saved. And now if I need to get back to this, which I will for further parts in this project, I click that right there and you can see there it is, right up top. And that's something you can share with the project as well, because eventually you're going to share this with me. So at any point you can click the share button and get the graph, right? So, all right, this is the first four questions essentially covered. Explain your thinking and you're good to go. Thanks.